Hello everyone, I'm Sapte Bhari Akash Tiwari. Today we have Mr. Anand Bhadkamkar, the CEO of Dan India. So Dan, Dentsu Aegis Network is world's second largest media and communication agency. And Anand is the CEO of Dan India. So make sure ki tum logo ko bhale hi mera shakal pasand na hai, but tum log uska pura podcast dekho. Okay? Theek hai? So Anand, before starting, I just want to ask you, how many times your name have been mispronounced? Like, Mr. Bhadkamkar or Bhadkamkar or Brahmaster, like, what is the main name you have got?
Yeah, first of all, pleasure to be here. I was going to sort of compliment you on pronouncing my surname properly, actually, in the first go.
Okay.
It actually at times comes in as Bhadkar or Bhamdamkar. So there have been very funny pronunciations, but yeah, the name it gets confused with Bhandarkar, Bhadkamkar. It says Bhadkamkar actually.
Okay.
Maharashtrian name.
Okay, so, I'm just assuming ki after watching.
Yeah, but thanks for pronouncing that perfectly.
You're welcome. So starting with it, I would just want to ask you, this is gonna get over, like COVID-19 is gonna get over. We gonna start with the same things. So what would be the opportunities and challenges? Like what would be the post-COVID world and how can we prepare for that?
Yeah, I mean, COVID is something which nobody had anticipated, right? I mean, irrespective of whatever business you are in, whether you're a student, whether you are a homemaker or you're working or whatever, you're having business or even the migrant laborers, right? Because something nobody imagined, behaviors are definitely changing. The way we were operating before COVID and post-COVID, that's definitely changing because social distancing, more awareness about health and keeping that separation between how we are operating, that sort of comes quite strongly. But what's changing very, very much actually, I don't know whether you remember, there's been this WhatsApp message which keeps on going. Who has in an organization, what has made the digital transformation? Was it CIO, was it CEO, or was it COVID-19? And I think most of the companies would say it's COVID-19 because what's happened is people have started working from home. No one had imagined that you would be at home for 2 months first and the work would go on. Many of the companies, the work is going on, except you're in manufacturing sector or something, that's a different one.
Yes.
But that is going to be a big change as you move back. The consumer behaviors are changing. People are going more on online learning or online shopping. The behavior of payments are becoming online, moving towards that. So that digital effect is definitely going to be much larger. In your day-to-day operations, then when you are commuting, keeping that social distancing. Or earlier, you used to have lunch on Uber, Olas, or the shared services. That shared mobility is something which we would need to see as we are moving. So that personal space, we definitely would see for immediate term, it's definitely going to be quite a bit of a change. And work front-wise, in offices, as you would have heard also, many of the companies are saying they'll start more work from home working. TCS has announced.
Yeah.
Or many companies in US also are saying, I don't want to have that workspace now. Why not I drop it by 50% or something up to 5%?
Yeah.
So that kind of a way would change more sort of at home kind of things for people. So that's going to be a complete change in this. From economic perspective, it's definitely, everyone is saying, like each country is saying it's India, we are saying make in India, Atmanirbhar, it's something which is coming up. There's a to that as well, right? Because dealing with other countries, how they are or what's happening over there, you really don't know. So it's better that you sort of are self-reliant as well. So any such thing comes in, you don't want to be caught off guard. So going forward, even countries, people, societies will be quite cautious, quite reliant in that way, and taking quite a focus on digital first kind of an approach actually.
Okay. So yeah, coming to digital, like I have read about it, you had said that 50% of your revenue was digital, which is a good thing. So have you guys capitalized on it or has that given you any advantage? And 35% of your, you guys are the market leader in out of home also, which is not working. So how are you planning to reorganize it? Digital, has it given you advantage and the out of home thing?
So both are, they're not two ends, but in a way they are different, right? And they are impacted in a very different way.
Yeah.
You see digital consumption, OTT platforms, or you would say your apps, Netflixes, Amazon, the consumption has gone up drastically, or even your online gaming. That's something which is taking up. So that definitely from business perspective, and as we are moving forward, that huge plus, right? Because companies want to be more tech oriented. You want to start tech programs and projects much faster. And that's something which is moving. Speaking purely from advertising perspective, definitely there's a huge impact, be it digital or TV or say out of home. it's largely impacted because there's no comms or trade happening in the market. Everybody is at home. No one is moving out. The sales are there only for those until now. It was for basic necessities, right? Because it was nothing beyond that. So that was something quite impacted. So while you, me, we would be watching more maybe movies, or you would be spending some time on okay, something like that. But that still doesn't mean in the commercial sense or the advertising sense of a marketeer, that's not something which gives him the advertising dollar by the publisher community, if you want to call it that way, right?
Okay.
So there's definitely huge traction. Digital is improving. But the other side of that is the form, which you mentioned, or events. It's purely a physical space. Wherever there is a physical interaction, that has come to a knot because people are not moving out. Or even if it's hoardings, out-of-home space. Unless people are out, there's no point in going and advertising or putting a billboard up because no one is going to watch that. So that is something which is drastically impacted. But as we are seeing coming COVID, we are trying to get more digitization into that space. Or when you're talking of events, it's more digital events. You can't create those physical events or something like happening on the grounds or those music shows which used to happen or even IPL is postponed, right?
Yeah.
People are not going to come there unless there's a clarity. You get a vaccine for COVID, it's going to be much, much sort of delayed and it's going to be impacted. So what's happening over there is we are looking at digital events or creating that virtual experience. So you use augmented reality for that or machine learning and then sort of driving that. So create that experience maybe home or if you're in offices because people start going to office. So creating that. So that's where we are moving on that events or out of home space and getting digitalization built in over there. So that's how we are trying to move in. And but you're right, means that out of home space or event space is going to take some time. They were leaders getting into the COVID problem in that sense. And they will be the laggards when it comes for businesses coming out of the COVID challenge actually.
Yeah.
That's how they are. And where digital has remained as quite constant, and I think it would lead the coming out of COVID as well much faster.
So as I told you, my audience is more of youth oriented, okay? I want to ask you, ki freshers ko kitna importance diya jata hai? And how can they pave their path into this industry, like media communications, advertising?
If you see freshers or if you see the average age which we have in our, and because a large portion is digital, It's around 25, 26 years is the age of our staff. That's our average, largest number of staff in our agencies is between 25 to 30.
Okay.
People beyond 40 are very few and beyond 45 still goes down. So it's a very young population. And in the digital space, there's huge scope for the young population if you're coming out. In social media, it's on digital creative aspect or search performance. We are doing digital marketeering. There's a huge scope over there, huge scope to learn. And from there are also a lot of learning opportunities and future opportunities where you want to move away from there. Not necessarily in media and advertising sector, but from there you want to be in other digital companies or tech companies. Or there's UI UX generation, you create consumer experiences. So all of that sort of comes in this entire spectrum. So huge scope for the young talent if you're coming out of graduation or you're doing your any media sort of graduation. From there, definitely huge scope learning consumer behaviors, taking data analytics. I think that's something which is sort of coming time and again for all the teams. So that's definitely a big plus for the young population. And that's what people are looking for, actually.
Okay.
Lots of opportunities out there.
Okay. This is one controversial thing which I want to ask you. Okay. So there's this one accusation which is made that a lot of ads are just made for the awards and not for clients. So is this true? And if yes, then what is your take on it?
No. So see, typically the awards are for celebrating the creativity, right? Because ultimately, when you say advertising, it's ultimately if it's media buying or media planning or anything, what works is the idea, right? Agencies are in ad business and are ultimately to go out and say that what works best and what was the best sort of creative or which was the best idea. Now that was perfect. So as in any competition, there would be certain cases where you would find such instances, like there would be entries you would find which aren't necessarily the chill advertising entries. It would be just sort of award related entries. You would find that kind of thing happening in multiple places. This used to be quite large earlier, But now all the award shows over the last 2-3 years or more than around 3-4 years, it has become quite stringent. And so when you're entering the awards also, the organizers do want to see that that actually has actually been placed in media or that actually has run through. So that malaise, it's not that it goes away. People might want to misuse because there would be some truants, right? So that always would come in. But I would say more than 95% of the awards or award entries which come in, they always are through the real work which clients and agencies have sort of done together. And ultimately, from my perspective, the awards or the award shows are more on celebrating that talent and celebrating that creativity and taking that forward. So I like to look at the positive sides of that, that how it sort of inspires other people and then sort of makes them move forward. Rather than living in the controversies and just sort of sulking in that, that what's happening or not happening. Take the positives and move on. And that's what I actually look at.
Like noted.
In the
noted.
Land King, that Hakuna Matata.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Got it. So, hum logo college mein aisa bahut baar bolte hai ki hamare haath mein kuch nahi hai. Professors say this ki hamare haath mein kuch nahi hai. And even in corporates, the seniors say the same thing ki hamare haath mein kuch nahi hai. Okay. So, as a CEO, what are those things jo aapke haath mein aisa kuch nahi hai? What are you not able to do?
No, see, aapke haath mein kuch nahi hai. It's nothing like that, right? Because it's ultimately your own, if it's to do with career or any decision making or what you're doing, it's ultimately in your hands, right? Because you'll have your sphere of control or there's this concept called your sphere of control, right? Because there are certain things which you need to know. There would be certain things which are within your control. Then as you keep on growing, then that sphere of control has to increase. It means you would need to influence some other people. If you are not a CEO or say you're a junior most person, you cannot take the call on, say, a company-wide call. But you can always create some environment towards that. You can, if you are so passionate about that, you can always start moving towards that. You can speak to your boss, your senior, or what is your thought? You speak out that thing. Take it forward. You can create or influence. Control is something which is, there are certain things which are in your control, which you can sort of impress upon or drive, that you'll do. But if today I say that I want to know, say I'm CEO of Dan India and I want to take call on what India's economy should be or what should our prime minister take as a call on stimulus, that's not in your control. But what you can do is if you really feel passionate about that, start going to social media, start creating that noise or awareness, ensure that that reaches the right place. As long as you look at that in a positive way and positive manner and looking at that, the outcome is something which you're looking for. You set the expectations also correctly and then drive us for that. That's something which you'll need to keep in your mind. But you can't just give up. You need to know what you're saying or what you're looking at.
Okay.
And mere control mein hai, that should not be used as an excuse. Means not to say that I just put the blame on somebody else. That's something you feel something passionately. Just go for that. Start driving and sort of working towards that. Start creating that. The example which I said of that sphere of control. It's me, then it might be my immediate boss. It might be wider than that. Or you are in a, say, a regional network and somebody in the region. How do you start creating that? And how do you start influencing? So that art of influencing starts becoming quite critical then as you move forward then.
Okay, yeah, art of influencing is very critical and important. So tell me, how are you using that art of influencing? Like, how are you working on that?
So that's something you need to use from time to time, right? Means if you see, speak about me, for me also, I've moved away from, I was a CFO up to last year in Dan, right? So I moved from a finance or a sort of function position into the business side or the CEO position. So that means speaking with a lot more people or engaging with a lot more people and then driving that. So it's essentially using your relationships and how you are dealing with your other counterparts and making your vision clear, making your outlook clear, and be open in your communication, transparent in your communications. That's something you need to be clear with. And I believe not going into a meeting with some hidden agenda or something sort of in your back pocket kind of thing. As long as you are transparent, you are open, and you have with a clear mindset and clear goals in mind, and you're looking at the right outcome, I think that's something which helps, and people do respond to that. So that's what you need to sort of look at. And art of influencing is definitely something which will come with time. You need to be more open, communicative, articulating yourself. So that's something which would be coming as you move on. But it gets vertical as you start moving on.
You've been into this industry for 21 years, I think so. Like 8 years in Lentas and then a year in Dan. So that's 21 right. years, 21 yeah. years, right?
That's right.
So in this 21 yeah. years, it's obvious that you had made some mistakes, right? So can you tell me like few mistakes, your major mistakes from which you have learned or maybe regretted it or anything like?
Mistakes in the sense, I can't sort of call out just now, whichever. I would say the positives definitely. I think one thing was joining Dan at that point of time, because when I joined, it was Aegis Media at that point of time.
Yeah.
And Lintas, which I was working for, was, and still it's a very strong company.
Yeah.
And when we started Aegis at that time, we were around 68 odd employees.
Hmm.
And from there, today we are 3,700 employees as we have grown over the last 11 years. So from there, we have come here. So when I was joining there, that was one big thing that, am I making a mistake by sort of leaving such a decent job and moving into this kind of a startup kind of a scenario or moving on? If that would have sort of worked out in a negative manner, that was a mistake. But it really has clicked. We worked together, the entire senior management team, which was at that time. All of us, we have stayed together, stayed true. And that's sort of benefited all of us. So that mistake is something, it's more as a learning, right? Because I won't say anything that sort of comes out.
Yeah.
It's going to give you a mistake or an error. Because you take some positive of that, say there are learnings and move on from there, rather than sulking on that. That's something which is a more important thing. So, as I said, if that would have been some negative, I said, big mistake, what did I do? The learning over there would have been, I should think twice before taking any such decision. But the counter side of that is that's working positive. Obviously, it's a good one, move on. So, everything is going to be positive if you keep that way. And what I think of, because it's my auditing background also, right? Because I was with Ernst & Young before that, before I joined Intas. So, we had this common thing that what could go wrong, right? Means in this entire thing, if something goes on, you're working on something, you're doing any transactions, something, what would go wrong on this? Just identify that and then move on from there, because you're just trying to protect and sort of cover that and take it forward. So there are more learning, I would say, you come across in your corporate journey or even in life also as you're moving on. So just take positives out of that and move forward. So.
Okay, got it. Let's come to small and medium agencies, or maybe, you know, there are a lot of media agencies right now who are working on a niche. Okay, there are maybe the media is only focusing on sports or maybe art or something. Okay, so what about these agencies? What should they focus on right now, and what should be their next step?
Small agencies, niche agencies and small agencies, both would be different, right? Because small agencies would be from size. Means when you say small, it's more on size basis.
Yeah.
But that again is each one's need also, right? I would put it into different parts. Means you have started some company or have started a business. I'm happy within what I'm doing, because that's what I want to be. And I want to enjoy something outside of that. If that's the case, then that small agency also is quite successful agency. It means it might be a 20 member or 10 member agency. But that's how, as a promoter, I had set out to do. And I had my multiple other things to be done around with that. Then that goes on as a small agency on its own sense. But whichever agency it is, what you need to be quite clear about is you need to sort of start future gazing. Because in whichever field you are, what's happening outside, what's going to come in, the new trends that are coming in, you don't want to be caught off guard, or you don't want to be sort of left behind when suddenly the things change. Now, in the current day, worlds are changing almost overnight. So you can't always be ahead of time, or you can always be sort of saying that I will know everything. But you need to be aware that what's generally coming in the market or wherever it's moving towards. So small agencies or medium agencies, that's where it would be. And from business perspective, do ensure you are well protected. You have your risks with you. Don't get overexposure. So when you're looking at growth also, you need to decide how you're growing. Are you having that sufficient backup for that? And then you're growing ahead. So don't try to over leverage, because we are in advertising or in service industry, right? Our critical talent or our assets are all of people. Nothing more than that. So we need to ensure is investing in people, investing in their talent or their learnings, and take it forward from there. And your other point about the niche agencies, where you need to focus on, if that's the niche you have identified, keep on specializing, because deep specialization itself actually sort of start giving you more benefits. Because if you have developed some skills and some specializations, definitely focus on that and keep on developing that. Just because something else is happening in the market doesn't mean that then I would give up my that niche area. Because true to your course is what at times you would call it, right? So that's something you need to do. But again, as I said, you'll need to see how the market is moving. And so you shouldn't be in that mind frame also that I'm specializing in this, so I won't do anything else at all. So there's a fine balance or that thin line you'll need to sort of trade on. But
I think that comes with experience or how you would see in the market as well.
Okay. So let's move on to quick rapid fires. Okay. No explanation, just answers. Yeah. Whatever you feel like. Okay. But answers should be spontaneous.
Yeah.
Okay. Myths or stereotypes about media industry?
It's just people party a lot. Or all night.
Coming late, working late. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. One thing WPP Group has, but you guys don't.
Scale.
Okay. And what is the other
scale
way around?
In the market. They're largest.
Yeah, obviously.
So, other way around, we have deep specializations in our digital out of home. So, we are much stronger on those counts. But okay. WPP, means are the true. Means they are the largest in the market, the oldest. They are the first agency in the country, actually. So they have that advantage as well. They started almost 110 years back. So more than first mover advantage in that way. Actually.
Yeah. Okay. So skills people should be learning.
Definitely digital.
Okay.
Or data analytics. That's something which should be coming.
Okay. Finance in the business or a financial, some other companies, and finance in a media company. The difference.
Finance in other industries and finance in media companies.
Yeah.
So in media companies, it's again, it's sort of completely unorganized. So it's like creating a fence around, you would say, on media and creative agencies. So it's like creating semblance or getting order in chaos. It's what the finance and media agencies need to sort of work around, because you got creatives around, you got all these people running with creative juices, and then sort of they just want to sort of go out, and whereas you need to get that semblance in or sort of get order in that entire chaos. Actually, if you go to the manufacturing sector, the network is quite structured. It starts from the beginning in the production line itself. It will be automated. It starts with a very organized manner. So
okay. Best campaign during COVID.
One is our Indeed team has done some excellent work, actually. Our CSR team. So working with some of our clients, Vivo or Maruti, on giving distribution of masks, or working with police or local government in sort of having that food distribution or something. So
yeah.
I would say in this COVID scenario, more than the creative work or getting the messaging across, it was more where the agencies went out which went out and supported teams. I think that was much more critical as the network. So CSR work by all the organizations which they did. That's something which I would rate much more than a TV commercial or a print commercial which came out, actually, because that was more messaging. But otherwise, what comes out is there was this film about all the film stars creating awareness about stay at home and be responsible. Mm-hmm. So those themes are actually quite useful, passing on that social messaging. But for me, the themes which were out there in the market or out there in the field and sort of doing that delivery, actually, that was quite critical, actually.
Okay, yeah. Shittiest thing you have witnessed being a CEO?
There's nothing I would say as a shittiest thing or a worst thing, because
weirdest thing, anything. Okay, you can sprinkle it.
So there's nothing like that. It's maybe at times people reaction or people behavior. That's something you would find at one day that you feel that's really weird. Or that's
We need one example.
So I can't remember as anything as shitty or something horrible or something. It like might be some negotiations behavior. Which go wrong.
Okay.
So the negotiations which might go wrong, or people just out of the meeting, actually. You're just trying to sort of have chats. So there was this one online meeting or call which we were having, and there was a disagreement. The person just walked off, and on the other side, the entire team was actually sitting on trying to explain. After 2-3 minutes, they realized that the other person has switched off, actually. A bit like that. So something of that sort. So that again is, again, your negotiations or something of that stuff. So it's
okay.
Experiences, actually.
Okay.
There's fun side in that also. So, yeah.
Oh, shit, man. I'm just imagining what would be that situation. Like, what would be their reactions? Okay. What do you think? Like, what are the vectors on which the things would go on? How would be the next media business spending on media, or how would the teams work? Like, there would be team members from Dan and freelancers, or what would be the next scenario?
No, so which, as I was saying earlier, right? Because as we are moving forward, this post-COVID, workforce still continue for a while. the teams are going to be together, but it's not going to be as it was before. Earlier, that it used to be every drop of a hat, people will have team meetings, or you'll be in a CCDA, or at the end of the day, might be sitting in a pub or somewhere, and then having those pitch meetings or discussions, right? That's not going to happen. That would be a lot through like Zoom calls or Teams meetings or your VCs, because with clients also, that's what clients would expect, right? Earlier, the production shoots and all, people used to be out there. Now that's going to be much more curtailed. So that's going to be sort of going to be a reduced way, lesser interaction, but more digital movement. And where media or growth is going to come from is definitely the digital will be growing quite a bit or quite fast. That's already happening. The digital transformation or marketeers moving more digital, e-commerce platforms getting much larger traction, because your normal deliveries are getting switched to that aspect. So digital interactions are going to go through the roof, I would say, or it's going to have a huge, huge upside. So that will something which moves towards. So wherever there is a digital engine, that will have a large play to move on. And from people perspective, again, freelancing or permanent employees, that's not going to be that much. It's based on how the work flows and how the experience and expertise sort of starts flowing in. So it's not going to be splitting between freelancing or in-house teams or something. It would move on as it is, but only from where you're delivering that service. I think that's going to change quite a lot.
Quite a lot. Okay. Actually, I had few questions. I put it on my Instagram and other LinkedIn everywhere, and people responded to it. So I had asked them any thoughts on media communication or advertising agencies. So I just want you to respond on few of them. Okay. Not all of it, but few of them. So here we go. The first person question asking is, why do most ads have emotional triggers and tear jerkers only instead of making an ad theme for brand? Again, the award thing.
See, that would change from each narrative, right? Because when you're doing a creative for a brand or where we are saying what is the target audience, because it will start with entire research. Whenever team working on that, it would go with the complete, what is the audience, what is the brand requirement, what is the reach, and what are the final end goals of that particular communication. So the creative which gets created, or it will be sort of generated, would be with that target audience in mind and where you are sort of trying to convey the communication. Okay. So Indian ads, I would say, even your Bollywood films and all also, right? Emotions are always quite high in an Indian sort of environment. Yeah. You compare that with American ad or European ad, much more drier in that way. So they are not with so much of emotion or personal interaction. Whereas Asian community as it is, it's more personal in that way. I mean, beat any Southeast Asian or you say any Chinese or Singaporean person also, you're more sort of personally impacted in that way in your emotions. Whereas you go to Europe or America, it's slightly lesser on that emotional aspect. So ads also at times follow that route, and sometimes they might go extreme way, but they're always goods and bads, right? So it's not like one size fits all, or it's saying that all the ads are like that. I think that won't be the right thing. There are some amazing ads which Lintas, O&M, and from Dents they've come up with.
Yeah, obviously. But so someone is saying ethical nahi unka kaam, like.
That may be each one's view, right? Because I like some ad, you like some ad, and advertisement or film creation or creativity is like that personal thing. Something which you like, you would like, but I might hate that completely. So it's each one's choice, actually. As long as there's no false communication or there's no claims in that, I think that's one of the basic things, actually.
Content marketing is going to grow at rapid speed, because that is the area which is like booming a lot, content marketing. And like the content creators working with the brands and agencies.
Yeah. So that's right. So your earlier question, actually, good you asked that, actually, that in future, what's going to happen or what's going where?
Yeah.
So what we have said earlier also is three V's which are going to rule as well. And post-COVID also, that will still continue, right?
Mm.
So that's going to sort of move in. Videos are going to be quite large. Vernacular is going to be quite large. And vernacular means regional.
Yeah.
And that content creation out of that. So that's something which will sort of move in. And that content creation is going to be critical for being on your OTTs, your platforms, or being on television, and see TikTok, or you get on YouTube or Facebook. Like TikTok, it's gone through the roof. It's
Now it's become so easy that anybody sitting in a village or somewhere, you can that just upload a video and you can start creating that and sharing that. So that content creation is going to keep on moving up, and that's where the entertainment starts coming. Influencers start coming in.
So, okay. Yeah, I.
And the third V is actually voice. Voice. So the search bit.
About us, the freshers, the young age. Okay. What they should be doing right now, and what should be their mindset?
So just now, definitely, as you see, if you are passing out or sort of you're into the final years or something.
Yeah.
This COVID definitely situation has changed quite a lot, right? Because it suddenly feels that what's going to happen, what's not going to happen. So currently, you have to be positive. Obviously, India has a huge growth potential. Means India's story is not going away. This year would be bad. That definitely looks like these two quarters are definitely going to be quite challenging. But businesses will bounce back. And by next year, it's definitely going to come up. And long-term, India has huge growth potential. So there's always positive. So the time currently which your generation or the youth have presently, taking more courses, learning more skill sets actually, taking something more, maybe it's on digital side or online is available in ample. So more on communications or more on any other skill sets which you want to sort of get on, arm yourself with and sort of start driving that forward. Opportunities will keep on coming. This is a slight dip for some time. From there, it's going to come back up. And it's again going to open up. So you should be ready for that and just be prepared for that. So as you start creating what do you want, have some brief plan. You can't plan for what's going to happen after 4 years or 5 years, because as you keep on, you'll keep on moving towards there. But broadly what you want to do, draft your sort of objective and start working towards that. And essentially in the current time when there's a bit of ambiguity, keep on arming yourself with more and more courses. There are Harvard courses or there are many other courses which are available online for free also nowadays, actually.
Yeah.
So just sort of keep subscribing and start learning more and more over there. And after that, if it's there, maybe you guys can join Dan also. So whoever are in marketing.
I am ready to do it. That's the reason I have a podcast with you. The next message is going to be, buddy, take me in Dan.
So, definitely.
Okay. So, I'm going to record this, you have said that we can join. What things you look at when you plan to acquire an agency? Like when you focus on acquisitions, what are the things you look into?
See, the acquisitions aren't way of necessarily growing your business. Just thinking that I will just grow my business. It has to be part of your growth strategy or your overall strategy. So when we look at acquisitions, obviously look at how they would fit into our overall long-term strategy. And what we look for is either it should be scale, that is, it should give us huge scale in the market, whichever business you are. It's not necessarily us, but when you're looking at an acquisition, either that should give you a scale. It's not just for buying profits. You want to have that muscle with you. That would be one thing. Second thing would be infill, means there are certain capabilities which you don't have with you. Then you would want them in your business. Either you develop them, or at times it might be a good idea to have a large business joining you and which catapults you to the next level. So you would do that. Or otherwise, it's the capabilities which are missing completely. There's a new set in the market that you want to sort of bring onto your business. Let's say its content is something which is developing much faster. It's not with you. You would want to develop that. Broadly on these three things we do look at, and almost all of the networks, all of the business also, you would try to see on these lines. If you are looking at acquisition just to add to your profit, that's not going to help you in the long term, because that's not something which will achieve. And what's most important in acquisition also is the integration, right? So that needs to work together. Culture of both the organizations, those who are acquiring and those who are being acquired. Because once the acquisition is done, people will be working with each other. If the culture is completely different, then it's not going to be a successful marriage in that way. So that gets quite critical. So we broadly see as a thumb rule, these things ought to be there. And obviously then there would be all concerns and other things which are coming in. So the commercial considerations, but basically your scale, infill or capability, that goes as the core thing actually when you would look at acquisitions also.
Okay. So thank you so much, Anand. I hope you enjoyed our podcast. Like, how did you feel? Like, it was good?
Yeah, it was really good. Good experience. It's really nice. It was a pleasure speaking with you.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Really well conducted.
So thank you so much for joining us. And I'm going to message you about joining Dan.
Sure. Definitely. Sure. Okay. Take care and all the best, Akash.
Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you, Anand. So that was Anand Bhadkamkar, and I hope you enjoyed the session. हम लोग ऐसे लोगों को और बुलाने वाले हैं, बहुत सारे अलग अलग लोग बुलाने वाले हैं. So make sure you learn, enjoy, and make sure कि तुम लोग हमें और भी suggest करो कि हम लोग क्या करना चाहिए. Just give us feedback and मिलते हैं हम लोग. Woo! Thank you so much.